The host of the show had so much makeup on.
Oh yeah, the TV shows.
I remember I just felt like if I had touched his face, I would have sunk in like up to my first knuckle into makeup.
You've spent your life. You were Pixar baby practically, it feels like.
Well, I was pretty young when I started. I was in my mid-20s, so I guess if that makes me a Pixar baby, then yeah.
Did you come directly out of school into the Pixar land, or did you?
No, I worked in live action and television for a few years before I ended up at Pixar. People like to trot out my sordid TV past. My first job out of school was working on the show called Silk Stockings that was on the USA Network.
A classic.
Yeah, yeah. It was great. It was, you know, I worked with great people and I learned a ton. I mean, anytime you work in television, you have to crank through so much so quickly. I mean, I think we did like 22 episodes a season. So I was editing. So I was just editing and editing and editing, and I learned a ton. I mean, you can look back at the show, and you know, it's not. I don't know that it will be remembered in the annals of TV history, but
it's
I learned
cut
a
like
ton
a mofo.
Doing it. Yeah.
You can probably go on Hulu now and see all the old episodes.
Probably
relive your childhood.
People just think it's funny that I did that. Now I'm making family films.
So was editing what was in your head when you came out, or was that the job that was available, or the thing that seemed to be in front of you?
One of the good things about USC, which is where I went to film school, is that you kind of have to do everything. You know, they make you take writing classes and directing classes, cinematography, everything. They don't let you specialize right away. And as a young film student, I, you know, like everyone else, I wanted to write and direct. That's what pretty much everyone wants to do. But once I got exposed to everything, I realized that I wasn't good at some things. Like I was never meant to be a cinematographer. That wasn't in the cards for me. I still wanted to direct, but I discovered that I loved editing. Editing was this thing that I knew very little about. Like most people don't know a lot about editing.
Right.
But I found that not only was I fascinated by it, but I was actually pretty good at it. So that's what I ended up focusing on quite a bit while I was in school. And that's how I started my career. Obviously, that's how I came up to Pixar, was as an editor, which is a weird way to enter the company.
How so?
Well, you know, one, I had no idea what an editor did in animation, period.
I still don't, so
it's
what does an editor do?
The editor's very, very involved, like much more than an editor is actually involved in live action, because they're brought on much earlier and they're actually a part of the writing process of the film. They're just kind of like a key component in the early development of the film in a way that you're not in live action. Live action editing is a very reactive game. You know, you have what you have. You have what was filmed on the set, and you have to make it work, which is great, and it's nice to have that challenge. But in animation, you have a lot more control. You know, if as an editor, if I don't have a shot that I need or that I'd like to have, I can pitch the director on it, and it doesn't involve having to go back to Tibet on location to get the shot that's missing. We can just create it. So it's very liberating, and thus the editor gets their hands much messier in the creative process. And I think that's why I kind of rose through the ranks like I did at the studio and started to direct, is that I brought a lot of that to the table. As a filmmaker and coming from live action, I brought a lot of skills to the studio that hadn't quite been there before. And John Lasseter recognized that, and he started delegating more and more responsibility to me. So the very first Toy Story film, I'm credited as the editor on the film, but I actually was very involved in the staging and all the camera work on the movie. And you know, John just kept giving me more and more to do, and before long it became clear that I was kind of directing the films alongside everybody.
So does this become contentious?
I mean, in terms of what?
I mean, if you're the editor and there's a director, and the director, you're saying, I need this shot, and the director is saying, you know, but I have a vision for working some other way. I mean, is there... I mean, we always think of Pixar as kind of being the happy family.
Yeah,
everybody
it is.
Brings each other flowers
it
every
is.
Day.
It's
and
not. It's not an illusion. I mean, it's very much. It's a very collaborative environment, and we truly love each other. I mean, we trust each other creatively, very, very deeply, and so no, there's no contention. I mean, we have, you know, you'll have heated conversations about the best way to do something or different ways to do it, but. You know, ultimately the director wins out because the director, somebody needs to have the creative final say on anything, and that's the director. So back when I was editing or even when I was co-directing, ultimately I had to, you know, it was up to the director whether things were going to end up in the film or not. But you know, if you're a good director, you listen to the people around you and let everyone around you help you make a better movie.
So does being an editor feel like post-production on a picture like that? Or do you feel like by the time you've gotten to the end of the process as the editor, you've also, the film has gotten to the end of the process and it's...
Yeah, it's really not post-production. It's really production. It's production and post. I mean, the editor's on from the pretty much the beginning when the film starts to be written, all the way to the bitter end of finishing the sound mix and the color timing. So it's you're in for the long haul when you edit an animated feature, certainly.
And so what was your sense that you were in a different world? I mean, did you feel like an animation person right
I
off,
didn't.
Or did it take some
no.
getting used to?
It took a lot of getting used to. Luckily, I was a big fan of Pixar. Uh-huh. I was aware of the short films that John Lasseter had been making,
mm-hmm.
Because I was a filmmaker, but I was also a computer geek, and mm-hmm. and it was the beginnings of computer-generated imagery, and I thought it was really cool. So I loved John's films, mm-hmm. and I was aware that they were going to be making their first feature. So when I got the call to come up and help on Toy Story, I jumped at the opportunity, mm-hmm. just purely for selfish reasons. I wanted to go up and see how it was done. I wanted to meet John and to see how he created these amazing short films that I'd been seeing. But yeah, I knew nothing about animation. I had dabbled a little bit in animation. Mm-hmm. You know, I'd done like flip books when I was a kid, and at film school I made a little kind of claymation film. But that was never anything that I was going after in my career. I thought I was going to be a live action editor and hopefully director at some point. When I got the call from Pixar 16 years ago, it was for a freelance gig. I was supposed mm-hmm. to just come help on the movie for 4 to 6 weeks.
That's how they get people to Emeryville.
And that was it.
Once you've gone up there, you can't leave.
Well, that's what happened to me. I mean, here I am 16 years later, and it's amazing. I mean, this is not at all what I had thought, how I thought my career was going to go, but I wouldn't trade it for anything. It's just been an amazing run.
So was there a moment where you went, okay, now I'm an animator, now I know animation, and I'm at peace
with
that?
It's funny, I didn't think that until now, really, after having completed Toy Story 3. I still mm-hmm. don't think of myself as an animator. I can't do what my animators do. They're amazing. Mm-hmm. And I'm not an animator. I know how to direct animators very well.
Right.
But I couldn't animate myself, although Bobby Podesta, my supervising animator, would say otherwise, because he actually had me animate a character in the movie. One brief little shot in the background. Oh. Nothing that I'm proud to share with anybody.
Okay, so we won't tell anybody. It's like an Easter egg inside of an Easter egg.
It is. I had a lot of insecurity about doing this. I mean, I felt it all along, even on the other films that I co-directed, mm-hmm. Monsters, Inc. and Finding Nemo. There was a lot that I felt comfortable doing, but I was always really intimidated when it came to working with the animators. I felt like kind of an interloper, because I didn't have that background, you know, going through CalArts like so many of the folks at Pixar did, and that I just wasn't an animator myself. Part of me felt like, who am I to tell them what to do when I can't do it myself? But what I came to realize is that I didn't need to. You know, I just needed to guide them. I needed to talk to them about the things that were important, like performance and motivation. And you know, I talk to my animators the way I talk to actors. And that's how they want it. I don't need to tell them the craft of what they do. They're working at Pixar. They know how to do that. They're the best in the world.
So is Lasseter working on 4 or 5 different levels when he's doing something? Because he is an animator, and he is a director, and he is a producer. And I mean, is it like there are different hats that you have to put on?
Yeah, definitely. And John has to wear kind of more hats than any of us.
Oh.
Because he is an animator first and foremost. That's how he thinks of himself, and a storyteller. But he's also directing, and he is also running 2 studios creatively. So he has a lot of plates to keep in the air. I think for all of us at our core, we're storytellers, and that's what's more important than anything. So we do have to wear other hats here and there, but ultimately everything's in the service of telling a good story.
So when you co-direct on something like Nemo, for instance, which is one of the great classics of the Pixar lore, as much as Pixar is a classic every year, what is it that you feel like was your thing you brought to the table for that movie as a director?
Well, I did a lot of things like supervising all the staging of the movie, all the camera work. I oversaw all the editing on the movie. I oversaw, you know, a lot of the sound work and the post-production. It was very much a divide and conquer kind of thing between me and Andrew. You know, there were things that were important to him that he focused on, and there were things that I was really good at that he felt comfortable delegating to me. At the end of the day, it the most important thing was the creative partnership that we had. You know, that he had someone who he could turn to and say, I don't know how to make this work. What do you think? You know, and that we could work on that level.
Because I think that was one of the things really on Nemo was that it was very, it's completely different than anything really you've experienced in animation, in part because of the sound and under the water. And I mean, it has a lot of elements that are not what we expected from animation and having that picture.
Right. Yes and no. I mean, you know, people pointed out a lot of the kind of more mature themes in that film as they have in Toy Story 3. And they think, well, this is so innovative. You're doing this in a kid's film. And the reality is we don't think of them as kids' films. We just think of them as films.
Well, Bambi still freaks everybody out.
Well, exactly. So. There's a film that was made decades ago that, you know, if you did something like that in a movie today, it would be considered groundbreaking. Yet that was done in the 1940s.
Let's go kill some animals. But you have kind of made, you know, Buzz Lightyear and the Temple of Doom here on some level. There is an element in Toy Story 3 that is darker than probably any of the other stuff at Pixar historically, no?
Well, you know, the Toy Story films have always had dark elements to them. If you go back to the first Toy Story, you had Sid's mutant toys, which were pretty creepy in his bedroom. I mean, we've always had a little bit to that. I think the best films are films that kind of give you a full experience. You know, they're funny, they're moving, and they're scary at times. I think we all like to be scared. Kids even like to be scared. So we're not afraid of getting intense if the story calls for it. And there were some moments in Toy Story 3, like the furnace scene at the end, that it's a pretty intense scene.
Yeah.
And we did have a lot of conversations about whether it was too intense for some people. And in the end, we decided that it wasn't.
So there's not a more intense version out there somewhere?
No. What you see in the finished film is exactly what we wanted to do.
And by the way, I like Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom more than the other two pictures. So for me, it's a compliment to say this.
Well, you know, that movie came at an interesting time because there was no PG-13 then. And I think that film got a lot of attention because there was no PG-13. A lot of people, you know, it wasn't an R-rated film, but it was pretty intense for even a PG.
So well, it wasn't as quite as easily family-friendly. It was a little more adult-themed, which I think is actually a great thing.
Right.
And I think the Toy Story movies and all the real Pixar movies, almost all the Pixar movies, really have that working on multiple levels thing where the kids enjoy the animation and the adults are getting something else out of it. So.
Well, and that's what we try to do. But at the end of the day, we know that kids are going to be a big part of our audience. So, you know, we don't want to put them off. We don't want to put anything in the films that's inappropriate. So we discuss it, and I think kids are stronger than a lot of people give them credit for. I mean, obviously there are things that they should be protected from, but there's nothing in Toy Story 3 that's damaging. I mean, it's there are some very intensely emotional moments, but I think it's good to expose kids to things like that. I mean, if you go back to the beginnings of children's literature, to Grimm's fairy tales, I mean, those were stories that were written for children to teach them about the dangers of the world, ostensibly.
Well, the hero's journey is the hero's journey. It's never going to be an easy cakewalk.
Life is hard sometimes,
and
life is sad sometimes. And I don't, you know, we don't see anything wrong with being honest about that.
And I think the greater emotion in that movie, the tear-jerking, is really for adults, not for, I don't know if the kids even would get the emotional weight of, you know, a kid going off to college and, you know.
No, they don't. They know it's sad on some level, but I think, you know, most kids watching the movie are probably empathizing with the toys more than Andy or maybe with Bonnie somewhat. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you're right. I mean, you know, a lot of people that are really affected by the end of the film have kids themselves or have sent kids off to college or have had their kids grow up and go off into the world and raise their own families. And that pushes a lot of buttons for people. But we found something interesting with the end of the film. I think some people were reacting to the end in a way on a whole different level than just the idea of a kid going off to college.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the toys in the movie spend the whole movie feeling unappreciated and like nobody loves them and they're questioning whether they ever really were loved and what is love. And you know, at the end of the film, they everything gets validated for them. You know, Andy does express to all of them how important they were in his life, and and he plays with them one last time, which is this ridiculous thing. If you said at the beginning of the movie, the 17-year-old boy is going to play with his toys again right. at the end of the movie, it's you'd laugh at it. Yet we did it in a we created a safe environment where he could do that, where he doesn't have his parents around, he doesn't have his friends, and he can just be a kid again. And for the toys, you know, they get that validation that they are loved and they are valued and appreciated. And I think for a lot of us, adults especially, you know, we spend a lot of our lives, you know, searching for that validation, and we want to feel that we're on the planet for a reason and that we've had an effect on people. And so I think people may not be aware of it, but I think a lot of emotion that people feel at the end of the movie kind of taps into those feelings.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's been a year, oddly, for some, there's always a theme that crops up in the movies at the end of the year that you don't really necessarily see coming. And I think this year, it's a lot of it's been characters, the main characters in movies kind of having to come close to death or dying in order to move on with their lives. You know, they have to touch that darkness in a way and really appreciate how good life is
right.
to keep on going. So 127 hours, you know, him cutting his arm off is a happy beat in that film because he's finally survived, you know, he's chosen to survive.
Right.
This is
what we did in the film. This is why we have the incinerator scene.
Yeah. You know,
we had to take them to that point for them to truly bond as a family in the movie. Without it, we wouldn't have that.
So John was notoriously anti-sequel forever, and there was big fighting between Disney and Pixar before the purchase about not wanting to do sequels and not wanting to go back to any of these stories. Obviously, Toy Story 2 was the exception to that rule, and then going back to the franchise, I guess, and going to do Toy Story 3, where did that process start, and was it kind of a slam dunk that this was going to happen and, okay, let's figure it out, or was it, do we have to find the right story or the right way of going at this to be willing to do it?
Sure. Well, to be clear, we were never anti-sequel.
Okay.
In our early days, a lot of people wanted to see sequels to the movies
mm-hmm.
because they loved them and they wanted more. And we didn't want to make sequels at the time because we were making our movies one at a time and we wanted to bring a lot of new stories into the world.
Mm-hmm.
But once the studio started to grow and we were able to have multiple films going, we were finally able to go back and say, well, okay, we can start thinking about doing some sequels. But we were very clear from the beginning that we didn't want to do a sequel just to, you know, cash in mm-hmm. and make some more money. So Toy Story 2 only came about because we had a story that we couldn't get out of our heads that we just thought was too good to not make.
Mm-hmm.
And then Toy Story 3, of course, it was, you know, 11 years after Toy Story 2 before that came about. We had been wanting to make a Toy Story 3, and we actually had an idea for one for a while.
Mm-hmm.
But there were kind of political problems between Disney and Pixar
mm-hmm.
That kept us from making another one for a long time. But then finally, when Disney bought us, all those problems went away, and we were able to finally sit down and make the movie. But interestingly, we looked at that original idea that we had, and we just decided it wasn't good enough and jettisoned it. And that left us with nothing, which was a little scary because we felt like, well, gee, we want to make a sequel, but we don't have an idea.
Right.
We kind of never wanted to be in that position.
Mm-hmm.
So we did a lot of soul searching for a couple of days. We went away to a cabin in the woods, which is this cabin where they had cooked up the original Toy Story.
Mm-hmm.
We thought it would be good luck to all get back together there. And we spent 2 days there with no phones, no meetings, nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Just we locked ourselves away, watched the first two movies, and talked about what we wanted Toy Story 3 to be.
Mm-hmm.
And it ended up being a blessing in disguise that we had to wait so long to make another movie. Because these 11 years had gone by,
mm-hmm.
we have all lived life more. John's seen his kids grow up, and he'd sent a couple of his boys off to college. And
mm-hmm.
And we had a different relationship with the Toy Story films. It felt like something from earlier in our lives.
Mm-hmm.
And so we made this kind of, I guess, bold choice to have Andy grown up, which is a little unusual for animation.
Mm-hmm.
Animation people tend to always stay in this state of stasis, you know, on The Simpsons.
Right.
You know, Bart never grows up. He's an eternal kid. But we...
But your characters are perfect. Your other characters are perfect for that.
Right. But in this case, we felt it was important to have Andy grow up and to
mm-hmm.
have the toys face the end of their time. I mean, Andy is their whole life. And what
right.
happens when your whole life goes away, comes to an end?
Mm.
It just felt like the right thing to do.
So how did Michael come into it, the screenwriter?
Michael Arndt?
Yes.
After Finding Nemo, I started working on developing some different ideas to original ideas to be my directorial debut at the studio.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not a writer myself, so I needed to partner with somebody. And I started looking around for writers. And one day, Michael's script for Little Miss Sunshine came across my desk. And I loved it. Mm-hmm. Thought it was fantastic, and I wanted to meet with him. And it was only then that I found out the film was actually in production. Hmm. So Michael came up, we hit it off, and we ended up hiring him. And the two of us worked together for about 6 months on this other idea. And at about the 6 month mark is when Disney bought Pixar, and John Lasseter asked me to set aside this other idea and to take the reins on Toy Story 3. And the very first person that I turned to was Michael and asked if he would stay on and write Toy Story 3. And thankfully, he agreed. And
he seemed to be the perfect fit tonally.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, you know, it was interesting because the whole run of Little Miss Sunshine happened while he was with us.
Right.
In terms of being a hit at Sundance and then coming out and everything that ultimately led to Michael winning the Academy Award for writing the screenplay. Mm-hmm. And he could have taken off at any point, you know, and I would have completely understood. But at that point, he had kind of drunk the Pixar Kool-Aid, and he knew what a good thing we have up at the studio.
I think it also kept him out of the muck.
Well, I mean, you'd have to ask him about that.
We did, what we were doing. I mean, during that year, we saw each other a lot.
Oh, yeah, he was happy to not have to be in the middle.
And I think he was kind
of
happy to be, yeah.
Michael's a very humble guy, and definitely doesn't like being in the spotlight.
Yeah.
So it was nice for him to be working and rooted in a project.
And working with people he trusted and, you know, felt something good was going to come of it. I mean, I think that was the...
Yeah, but it was really risky for all of us. I mean, but mostly for me and Michael to be doing Toy Story 3. I mean, we didn't want to go down in history as being the guys who screwed up the Toy Story franchise. And so we felt the weight of it very much so for a very long time during the production. Michael felt it, I felt it. Thankfully everything worked out, but there was no guarantee that it would. I often refer to it as fear-based filmmaking. You know, there's something about having a fire under you each and every morning when you wake up that can drive you to do your best work.
So is that all happening in slow motion, or is it happening with the deliberate speed of being on a production, on a live production?
Well, on a live production, once you actually go into production, there's a lot of money being spent, obviously, and so things have to go quickly. But before production, you often have a few years of writing, and that's what we had. And we spent about 2.5 years working on the screenplay and storyboarding and doing all the story development on the movie. So that's definitely not happening fast.
Right.
But once we kick into gear and we're animating, we're on a bullet train at that point.
And is it much changing in the script as you're animating?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, once we animate something, it's pretty much done. You don't want to change things after you've animated them because the animation is so expensive and time-consuming. You want to make sure you've got it right and you're happy with what you have. But anything that hasn't been animated is free game. It's fair game to be revised and rewritten. And we do. We rewrite right up to the bitter end.
So is it all the different people, who are involved, who are contributing ideas or saying, well, maybe we should go in this direction, or is it you guys huddling yourselves and seeing how it's going, or?
Well, ultimately, it's Michael and I that have to have the final say over, you know, what's going to end up in the movie. But we collaborate with a lot of really great people. I have a whole team of storyboard artists, and people often think of the storyboard artists as people who just draw what the movie's going to look like, but they're actually story guys. They're contributing gags and lots of ideas. A lot of times, for instance, there's a scene in the movie where Woody has to kind of break out of the daycare center, and he ends up escaping on a kite and to get out. He ends up hitching a ride on a janitor's cart, and he has a whole thing in the bathroom. Mm-hmm. That was a scene where Michael and I talked a lot about the fact that Woody needed to somehow get out of Sunnyside, but we didn't quite know how to do it. Mm-hmm. And so I ended up giving that scene to one of my young storyboard artists, and I said, Woody needs to get out somehow. It needs to be difficult. It needs to be something that he couldn't do again twice if he needed to.
Right.
But it can't yet feel like a prison, because we wanted to hold off on that feeling until later in the film. And I gave it to Adrian, and he came up with the whole idea of the toilet and the escape from the bathroom and the kite and everything. Mm-hmm. So that's just a great example of how it's not just me, it's not just Michael. There's a whole team of great folks that are contributing to the story on the movie.
And you knew that had to happen in daylight, because nighttime is when the prison element kicks in.
Right. Yeah. So, yeah, and you know, for that story, there are 100 other stories of unique, funny, interesting things that ended up into the film that got there from people besides me and Michael.
So does it ever feel done, or does it feel done the day you put it in a DVD case? Or
To be honest, that's actually the moment that's how I always mark my true end on these films, is the moment that I can take the DVD and slip it in onto the shelf alongside my other Pixar films. Mm-hmm. And actually filmed myself this year doing that and put it on my Twitter feed. Because I've done it on every movie. It's like the movies are so hard. Mm-hmm. And there are points while we're making them where we think we're never going to be done. We're never going to figure it out. But I've gotten to the point where I know that moment's going to come. Come hell or high water, the movie's going to be finished, and there's going to be a moment where I'm going to have a DVD that I can stick onto my shelf.
So is that an emotional ending as well, or do these things stick with you for a long time after you're done?
They do. You know, you asked if we're ever done. We often joke that our films are never finished, they're just released. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of true. Because it's like a car leaving the factory, and the people are kind of rubbing it and buffing it as it heads out into the world. And that's how it feels with our movies. Thankfully, though, we're given the time and the latitude to really polish these movies to where we're really happy with them. When I look at Toy Story 3 now, there's very little that I would do differently. I mean, I'm very happy watching the films. I've heard of a lot of filmmakers that can't bear to watch the movies, their own movies, because it's just too painful, and they see all the things that they wish they had done differently or that they didn't have time to do, or compromises they had to make. Mm-hmm. And there are a few very tiny cases of that on this film, but I'm mostly very happy, and it's the movie I set out to make.
And were those compromises or mistakes? I mean, are the things that
mistakes.
You think you just didn't do it right?
There were a couple of very minor mistakes, and then there was one case where we came up with a... There was something I maybe would have done a little differently in the story, but we were so far down into production at that point that it just wasn't realistic, and I knew that the film would be fine if we didn't make the change.
So when you push the movie out and you have the response you had this time, which, I mean, Nemo was kind of the high mark before this, and now this is the new high mark for animation, really.
You mean financially?
Yes, financially. Yeah. Does that matter to you? Or are you conscious of I mean, obviously you're conscious of it, but is it part of the issue of...
Yeah, but I'm conscious of it, but in my mind, when a movie does as well as Toy Story 3, the only way you can make that much money, you know, the 1 billion plus worldwide, is when people go to see it more than once, right? And people don't go see a movie more than once that they don't like. So I just take it that a lot of people liked the movie that we made, a lot, and liked it enough to go see it twice, three times. I mean, I have people... contact me, we've seen it, you know, 15, 20 times.
Well, people forget also that with the animated films and other films that are made for families, you have a lot of tickets that are sold to kids. And those tickets are usually half price or nearly half price of what the adults are paying.
Right.
So an R-rated movie that does $100 million, an animated movie that does $100 million are probably being seen by 20%, 30% at least more people.
Right, yeah, true.
So,
but again, I want the movies to do well because I want to keep making movies at Pixar.
Right.
Right. And when our movies are successful, that gives us the creative freedom to keep doing what we're doing.
Is that a conscious thing? I mean, do you guys even think that it's possible that you won't have the creative freedom? It seems like you guys have your tent is so magical.
Well, as long as our films continue to do well,
right.
You know, we're going to be allowed to continue to do what we do. You know, we've been very lucky that we've had 11 films in a row that have done this well. It's unprecedented. And you know, everybody's trying to figure out how we've done it. And we don't even really quite know. We've just kept making films the way we've made them since the very beginning. You know, we've paid a lot of attention to story, a ruthless attention to story. We don't allow ourselves to wear blinders as we make the movies. We air our dirty laundry quite a bit to our fellow filmmakers at the studio, in the hopes that we can get good feedback from them, very good honest feedback, and it just helps make the movies better.
Well, I mean, sticking to one a year is certainly, I think, part of that thing.
And then not trying to make too many.
You're getting caught up in the fact that you have a franchise and now you have to shove out more product and have to do the DVD, spin-off DVDs and all the stuff that corporations tend to do. It seems like it's still, in its own way, a mom-and-pop operation.
It feels that way. It helps that we're up in Northern California, that we're kind of away from Hollywood, doing our own thing. We come down here and touch base now and then, but mostly we, Yeah, I mean, we feel very grounded in our lives. You know, we go home at the end of the day to our families, and we don't have neighbors that are in the film industry. And when we go out to dinner, the waiters aren't trying to slip us headshots at the end of the meal. We have very normal lives. We feel very lucky. I mean, I feel very lucky to get to make movies, but live a kind of pretty normal life.
And do you expect to follow the path? I guess he followed you in a way of Brad Bird and head off and do
into live action.
Some live action again.
Well, Andrew Stanton's doing it as well with John Carter of Mars.
Yeah.
You know, someday we'll see. I'm very happy doing what I'm doing right now. I feel mm-hmm. very lucky. I've done live action, and I know
right.
it's very, very hard working in live action. And my personal experience was that I had to compromise quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And what's been intoxicating for me at Pixar is that I don't have to compromise. Everything
right.
that I want to do, everything that I want to put up on screen, I can put up on screen.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have, you know, budgetary constraints or, you know, schedule constraints. A lot of very real things that affect, you know, the end result of a lot of live action films are not concerns for us.
Yeah.
And that's been very liberating and exciting. That being said, you know, my roots are in live action,
right.
and I love that. And I mean, live action is its own thing, and I do miss the spontaneity of working in live action.
Well, John Carter is a Pixar production on
It's not. It's Disney.
It's not. It's just
yeah,
Disney.
It's not Pixar.
Okay,
yeah.
I thought it was directly connected.
No, no.
Okay.
Yeah, and Brad's off doing Mission Impossible, new Mission
yeah.
Impossible film.
And
you know,
he waited a long time. He was
well. He's
he was trying to do live action. For
I mean,
a while.
He and Andrew, they vote. They're both. You know, I think the fact that they are doing live action, that I came from live action, that you're seeing other directors like Andrew Adamson
mm-hmm.
Moving into live action from animation,
mm-hmm.
hopefully to people is a testament to the fact that we're just filmmakers. You know, yes, we can make movies using animation, using that medium, but
mm-hmm.
First and foremost, we're filmmakers and storytellers. And you know, it's been very gratifying on Toy Story 3 that the critics and the audiences and everyone has been talking about the film as much as they have, and that, you know, we're very grateful for the awards recognition that we've been receiving and the talk that we've been getting because we think our film should be able to sit alongside any other film.
And are you going to have to be responsible for making the animation for the Academy Awards when they ask you to do that next week? Or next Thursday, to animate Buzz and Woody and everybody for the Academy live action telecast.
Yeah,
moment.
Well, we've got people at the studio who are
who handle
that stuff and are great at it. Yeah.
So you can just watch your DVD on your shelf and
yes.
And do the awards phase you? Does this whole thing about Best Picture and you know versus Best Animation and all of that?
I'm just happy to be sitting here talking to you about it. To be perfectly honest, I mean, when we were making the movie, I don't know if you can put yourself in my shoes, but here I am making this film on the heels of all these other Pixar films that have done really well
mm-hmm.
and have won a number of Oscars for the different
right.
filmmakers. And I thought, well, that's great for them, but I'm making a sequel. I'm making
mm-hmm.
Toy Story 3. You know, what movie with a 3 after the title has ever gotten any awards recognition? I just thought it wasn't in the cards for me on this
yeah.
film. So I put any thoughts of that or hopes or dreams aside a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I just set about to make the best movie that I could. So the fact that this is all happening right now and we're getting this kind of attention, it's frankly, it's really surreal. And it wasn't anything that we expected.
Toy Story and Lord of the Rings are the parallel adventures, I guess, on some level. So, and now you feel like you're ready just to put on a tuxedo and go to events.
If that happens, I'll be happy.
Well, you're going to get
there.
You know that we know it's going to happen. Certainly on certainly for animation, and I don't think there's much question about getting a Best Picture nomination at this point.
Well, this question in my mind. I mean, until the nominations come out, we'll see what happens. Hopefully, it would be very nice if that happened.
And does the next movie have to do $1.2 billion in order to satisfy you?
No, I'm kind of happy that this film did so well because I feel like no matter what I do in my career again, I don't need to top this. I feel like it's been kind of amazing that this has happened and I don't have to shoot for anything beyond
yeah.
it anymore. I mean, I'll always try to make great movies, but you know, I think this is kind of a once in a lifetime kind of an event.
It was a fascinating thing for the studio, I think, because you know, when Ratatouille got written off and Up got written off and it was like
before it came out.
Before they came out
yeah.
and then they became what they've become. you know.
Well, the thing that's exciting to me is that that I'm very happy about is if you look at two of our biggest films, which were Finding Nemo and Up, mm-hmm. were the films that people really didn't have faith in early on, and that people, mm-hmm. You know, there were a lot of people saying that they thought Finding Nemo was going to be Pixar's first bomb, mm-hmm. and they said the same thing about Up. They weren't highly anticipated films because they were so far out of the box and unlike anything that mm-hmm. you know was out there. And but it was nice. It felt good for us to be in that position because we knew we had with both films that we had something special on our hands. Mm-hmm. And it was just mm-hmm. a matter of getting it out into the world. And so I love that the two films that people didn't have faith in ended up going on to be our biggest hits at the studio mm-hmm. until Toy Story 3 came along.